Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the Son of Man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see him. Those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity. One of those whom people hid their faces, spurned, and we held him to no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way, but the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought of any more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light and fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty, because he surrendered himself to death, and was counted among the wicked, and he shall take away the sins of men and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries, tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of our reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he had suffered, and when it was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
Whom are you looking for?
They answered him,
Jesus the Nazarene.
He said to them,
I am.
Judas's betrayer was also with them. When he said to them, I am, they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked,
Whom are you looking for?
They said,
Jesus the Nazarene.
Jesus answered them,
I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go.
This was to fulfill what he had said. I have not lost any of those you gave me. Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
Put your sword in the scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that my father gave me?
So the band of soldiers in the tribune and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas. He was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and other disciples followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate so that the other disciples, the acquaintances of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?
He said,
I am not.
Now the slave and the guards were standing around the charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold. and they were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret, I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
Is this the way you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered him,
If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him,
You are not one of his disciples, are you?
He denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Jesus had cut off, said,
Didn't I see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then he brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium, and it was morning. And they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out and said,
What charge do you bring against this man?
They answered him and said to him,
If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you.
At this, Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews answered him,
We do not have the right to execute anyone.
In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back to the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to them,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you say this on your own? Or have others told you about me?
Pilate answered,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priest handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here.
So Pilate said to him,
Then you are a king.
Jesus answered,
You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate said to him,
What is truth?
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?
They cried out again,
Not this one, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the disciples and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and placed it on his head. Clothed him in a purple cloak, and they came to him and said,
Hail, King of the Jews.
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him.
So Jesus came out wearing a crown of thorns and a purple cloak, and Pilate said to them,
Behold the man.
When the chief priest and the guards saw him, they cried out,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him.
The Jews answered,
We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard these statements, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
Where are you from?
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you, and I have power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin.
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called the Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Golgotha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king!"
They cried out,
take him away, crucify him."
But the chief priest answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then they handed him over to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carrying the cross himself, he went out with what was called the place of the skull, Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus, the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'"
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see whose it will be."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled, they say, "They divided my garments among them, and for my vestures they cast lots." This was what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus with his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples there, whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now fulfilled, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine, so they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it in his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over his spirit. Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, then the other, one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled, "Not a bone of it will be broken." And again another passage said, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it in burial cloth along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in this place where he was being crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Every Good Friday, the Church's liturgy proclaims the Passion of Jesus Christ according to the Gospel of John. The reason for this arises from both the content and tone of John's Passion narrative. The content here is similar to that of the Synoptic Gospels, the arrest at Gethsemane, the Jewish trial of Jesus, and the denial by Peter, the trial before Pilate, the crucifixion, and the burial of Jesus. Unlike the Synoptics, there is no mention of the institution of the Eucharist. For John, the highlight of the whole narrative is the crucifixion. This is the ultimate hour toward which the whole event has been building. It is the moment of Jesus' exaltation and victory. This is what makes this particular Friday good. Early in John's Passion narrative, we are told that Jesus knew everything that was going to happen to him. This knowledge will continue throughout the entire narrative. Because of this knowledge, Jesus is also in control of everything that happens to him. He quickly reveals that himself as I am 4 times, immediately overwhelming all those attempting to capture him. This is very different from what we find in the Synoptic Passion narratives. From the very beginning here, Jesus takes charge of the verbal exchanges with the Jewish officials who oppose him. In the Synoptic Passion, Jesus says very little. In John's, Jesus talks almost incessantly, including a very aggressive self-defense. The heart of the narrative is the trial before Pilate. Notice the movement from outside to inside. 7 times, Pilate attempts to understand what is really going on. In fact, Pilate is being put on trial by Jesus, who will die as the victorious king of the Jews. He will not die until he says it is finished. This moment of his death is actually his exaltation and glorification. This is the hour for which Jesus was born and to which he had always been drawn since in the beginning.
For the Holy Church. Let us pray, dear beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that God, our Lord, be pleased to give her grace and peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name through Christ our Lord.
For the Pope, Let us pray also for our most holy father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that unto him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
For all orders and degrees of the faithful, let us pray also for our Bishop, Sean, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
For catechumens, let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness of all their sins, through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Almighty ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
For the unity of Christians, let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth, to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
For the Jewish people, let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, hear graciously the prayers of your church and the people you first made your own, may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
For those who do not believe in Christ, let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ, that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love, and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world, through Christ our Lord.
For those who do not believe in God, let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right and sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself.
Almighty ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you, and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love in the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
For those in public office, let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure through Christ our Lord.
For those in tribulations, let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
For those suffering from the current pandemic, let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that He may extend His hand of mercy to all those affected by the coronavirus pandemic.
Almighty ever-living God, heal those who are ill, comfort those who mourn, give solace to all who are afraid and alone, and protect those who are providing medical care. Make us instruments of your peace among our brothers and sisters. In your mercy, alleviate our fears and eliminate this scourge, so that we may come together again to give you praise and to build your kingdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy be for me protection in mind and body and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.